Hi, I'm Nance Warren, and welcome to the first edition of Buckeye Bigfoot. Now, if you're like most people, when you think of Bigfoot or Sasquatch, you immediately think of the Pacific Northwest, Alaska, or maybe the swampy southern states. But Ohio actually has a long history of credible Bigfoot sightings, with accounts beginning centuries ago, leading up to the more modern accounts. We will be telling those tales, so go get yourself something to drink, pull up a comfy chair, and sit with me as we tell the tale of Jenna and Chris and their encounters with a Buckeye Bigfoot near the Blue Rock Forest back in the early 1980s. Thank you, Jenna, for allowing me to tell your story. You know that old saying that anything that seems too good to be true usually is? Well, it's absolutely true. But in late 1982, that is my husband Chris and I, could only think of the unicorn right in front of us. And by that, I mean the perfect house. Not that the actual house itself was perfect, but it was situated where and how we wanted and had all the particulars we both had been looking for. It had land, woods, and the most important thing of all to me, no neighbors in sight. You see, I had spent a lot of time in my youth growing up on my grandparents' farm outside of Corbin, Kentucky. It was 113 acres of cattle pasture, crops, and the back half of the property was heavily wooded. It was a dream when I was a kid. But let me tell you the best thing about that place down there. You know what? Not a single neighbor in sight. Now, the reality of being an adult and living in the city had begun to weigh very heavily upon me. I found myself dreaming often of those pastures and woods from my youth. I became depressed when every window I looked out of in my little suburban home only gave me a view of my neighbor's brick. Now, it didn't really matter to my husband where we lived. He worked calibrating, troubleshooting, and repairing a specific machinery whose brands were found in numerous manufacturing companies, and he generally spent some combination of a few, or more often than not, all the days between Monday and Friday, traveling throughout the Midwest and the Great Lakes region, and so it didn't matter to him where we lived. In his own words, he said, "On my way home, well, every commute home is a long commute." So this meant I spent a lot of my time alone, but I was okay with that. I was, and still am, perfectly happy being by myself. So in the fall of 1982, we happened to find our little house near the edge of the Blue Rock Forest, and we moved in just before the new year. Now, we had been told that the previous occupants were elderly and had lived there since the early 1950s, but wanted to make the move back to the city because they wanted to be near their children and that they needed to be closer to doctors as health issues had come up for them. We were told this the very day we first looked at the property, and the listing agent made sure we understood why some things were the way they were, projects started and not finished, things of that nature. It all seemed very plausible to me. After all, that is exactly how it happened for my grandparents, and that is why their farm was eventually sold. Now, this fact that the elderly people may have left things undone was pointed out to us as we walked the property, and the listing agent specifically stressed that again as we walked the area around the pole barn out back and came near the tree line. We could see that it was clear that someone had begun to try to move the tree line further back away from the pole barn and the surrounding area. There were literally hundreds of tree stumps everywhere. It was haphazard, and it looked as if it had been hurriedly and sloppily done. The line of stumps went about 10 to 12 feet deep into the previous tree line, but seeing that it had actually been cut to that depth for about 200 feet along the front of what was once the tree line, we could see it had been a monumental task. We just assumed the old man tried to do it himself rather than pay someone, and could not finish it, most likely for health reasons. Seemed plausible, right? We thought no more of it. Soon after moving in, we settled into what we came to look back on as an idyllic time. We were happy, and we enthusiastically worked on upgrading the interior of the house. When spring rolled around, I could hardly wait to get outside and start on the garden I had planned all through the winter months, and Chris was happily organizing the pole barn for his woodworking, which was actually a very serious thing for him. It was far more than a hobby, and he was good at it, too. He had made several things, including several pieces of furniture that he sold in the early days of our marriage for extra income. So, not just a hobby for him. But our first inkling that something was happening on our little piece of heaven came late one Saturday night in April. We were sitting on the deck, watching the sun go down after dinner, soaking up the fresh air after being cooped up inside for months. The trees were just beginning to bud out at the tips, and the branches were still bare enough that we could see the sun through the forest as it sunk below the trees. I was mid-sentence talking to Chris about something or the other when he hushed me. "Shh! Did you see that?" he asked me. "What?" I said. "Where?" I hadn't seen anything. He never raised his hand from the arm of the chair, but rotated his wrist and pointed towards the pole barn with his forefinger. "There, near the pole barn." I looked in the direction he pointed, but I didn't see anything but trees. And I told him so. "Wait, just keep watching. It's there. It's right there. It's just not moving. Wait a second. Just wait." I wasn't sure what he thought he saw, but I'd been married to him long enough to know that he was serious about whatever it was. So I stayed silent and watched with him. "There," he said, and I saw it. I did. I saw something. What I had taken to be a leafless tree in the tree line had moved. Just a few steps, then it stopped, and it quickly took another couple small steps, and it stopped. Suddenly, I could feel the hair on the back of my neck stand up. I knew for certain that thing was watching us. About the time I began to think that, it took a couple more quick steps and then leaped behind the pole barn. Now, I couldn't have said for certain how tall it was or what features it had. I only knew that I had seen a dark mass moving. My first thought, as everyone's usually is that it was a bear. It seemed natural to me after spending my time in Kentucky, where literally a bear could walk out of the forest when it smells bacon in the morning. We weren't far from the Daniel Boone National Forest, and it was known to happen. But then I reminded myself, Ohio didn't have any bears. At least not at that point, although I'm told they do have them now. We waited a few more minutes and saw and heard nothing else, so we assumed whatever it was had gone on its way. We were just talking about how it was getting a little colder and maybe it was time to go in when we heard a metallic thumping noise. It seemed to be coming from behind the pole barn. Whatever it was, it was back. Then we could hear metal rattling, as if it was maybe trying to get into the pole barn, and at the same time hitting it aggressively. Suddenly, Chris stood up and started yelling, "Hey! Hey! Get out of here! I'm calling the police!" "What are you doing?" I asked him. "Well, if it's a bear, that should scare it off. And if it's some teenager thinking this place is still empty and it's a great place to party every weekend, I'm letting them know it's not." Well, Chris was pretty mad by that point. We stood there for a few more seconds and heard nothing but the breaking of branches as something retreated to the forest. "Tomorrow," Chris said, I'll run into town and get some of those motion-activated lights and put them round out on the pole barn. Okay, I said. We walked into the house for the night, locking up everything securely and leaving the outside light on the deck on for the night. Chris wanted to make sure those teenagers knew somebody was home. The next morning, Chris went out and checked all around the pole barn, and when he came back in, he said he didn't really see much. Well, I found out later, he'd actually seen quite a bit that raised his awareness, but he didn't want to alarm me, so he said nothing. But he did go into town and bought a lot of motion-activated lights and spent the afternoon installing them. That night over dinner, he asked me to please stay close to the house until we were certain the bear, or whatever, was gone. I said okay. I didn't mind. I knew I had plenty to keep me busy inside the house this week, and it was going to be raining, so it wouldn't be a problem. In fact, I was working down in the family room. I had taken out some old bookshelves on either side of the fireplace and was patching and painting and doing a lot of other updating down there. And Chris had already drawn up plans to build some new bookcases and install them for me. That was the plan for the next weekend. So, the Friday rolls around, Chris comes home and finalizes his shopping list for the bookcases. Saturday morning, he headed out early, ran errands in town, picked up some groceries for me, and made his last stop to pick up the wood. Now, I need to let you know that one of the wonderful things about the way the house was situated was the driveway came in off the main road, along the right side of the house, into a carport, and then went further back to the pole barn and ended in front of the garden area. It was nice and it was convenient. So it was mid-afternoon when I heard Chris honk the truck's horn in the carport to let me know he was back. I went out the side door, grabbed the bags with the groceries and a few other things I had asked for, and he moved on down the driveway and parked in front of the pole barn. As I moved around the kitchen putting the groceries away, I caught a few glimpses of Chris from the window and saw that he was unloading the wood from the truck and carrying it into the pole barn. Once the groceries were put away, I went back to the family room and tried to finish up all the painting that I could and actually completed more than I had planned. But after a couple of hours, I realized that if we were going to eat dinner that night, I needed to clean up and start prepping the food. It was just after 7 o'clock when I walked into the kitchen. While it was still early May and the days were getting longer, by 7 o'clock the sun was already going down and the forest was leaving long shadows across the yard. I knew this meant that I would be grilling with the porch light on, which, as you know, is a pain in the you-know-what. So I put the steaks in their marinade quickly and prepped the foil packs of potatoes and started to head out the sliding glass doors onto the deck to start the charcoal for the grill. I hadn't made it two steps out onto the deck when I froze and my heart almost stopped. Vaguely, my mind registered the eeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeeee And I could also hear, between each run of the power tool, his little radio blasting away with music. I asked him later what he was doing at that time, and he said he was cutting dados, whatever those are. But it wasn't what I was hearing that terrified me. It was what I saw. Right there, standing next to Chris's parked truck, stood the outline of a large, hairy thing. It was silhouetted in the light that was shining out of the pole barn. It just stood there, not moving. It was still light enough out that it was visible to me from the back. I could see the hair, the fur, whatever you want to call it. Whatever it was covered with, it was a black brown color, like a dark chocolate chip. Not black, not brown, but a little of both. The fur was a little shorter on the head, I could see that. It lay close to the skull, like a skull cap. and I had the impression that the fur covering it wasn't exceptionally long, but it wasn't short like a real short-haired dog or cat either. It was an inch or two long, maybe, but it hugged the body very close. Later, using the truck as a gauge, I guesstimated that the thing stood 7.5, maybe close to 8 feet tall. But as I said, I was frozen, except for my mind. You know, it was doing that thing that your mind does when it thinks through 100 scenarios all in a nanosecond. And I really don't know if I could have screamed at that moment if I had wanted to, but I knew that I shouldn't. My mind had already told me that screaming for Chris would be useless. He would never hear me. But that thing standing there, would. Indeed, it would. And from there, my mind couldn't tell me what would happen. I also knew Chris had laid out the interior of that pole barn, which meant that Chris certainly had his back to the door, almost certainly. And that meant my husband had his back to the beast. And it was that thought of that thing creeping up on Chris without him knowing, that is what put me into action. Again, in a nanosecond, my mind told me exactly where to go and what I needed to do. Now, some of you listening might have done something different. And it's real easy to be a Monday morning quarterback, but at that moment, my brain was telling me what I needed to do. Now, I have no memory of going back inside, no memory of going into our bedroom closet. I only have a vague memory of tearing through that closet like a wild woman. I was after the only gun we had, a .22 rifle left over from Chris's days as a young boy when he liked to pretend he liked to go hunting just to spend weekends with his grandfather, who was an avid hunter. Now, for the record, I had never fired that gun, or any gun. But I didn't think about that. I just had to do something before that thing did whatever it might do. I didn't know what that could be, but I knew I didn't want to find out. I have no memory of returning to the deck. All I remember is coming to a dead stop once I reached the deck. It was gone. I stood there for a moment, my insides shaking. I looked around wildly. Where is it? Where did it go? Did it hear me when I ran inside? Did it go back into the tree line? Oh my God, is it in the pole barn with Chris? I could hear the eek, eek, and I could hear the little radio. So I didn't think it was in there. But my mind did another nanosecond gymnastic leap, and it processed my whole situation. And it told me one thing, and it said that the only thing scarier than me seeing that beast was not seeing it. I didn't know where it was, but I had the gun, and I decided I was going to chance it. I knew it would be dark soon, and I had to let Chris know it was not safe out there any longer. I remember bolting down the deck steps and running as fast as I could to the metal pole barn, clutching the rifle to my chest the whole way. I began yelling Chris's name as soon as I entered the doorway, and he looked up in surprise at me. As soon as I made eye contact with him, I whipped around and put my back to him. I needed to keep my eyes on the door. I kept looking over my shoulder at him, trying to get enough breath to tell him what I had seen. It's not a bear, Chris. It is not a bear. It was right here. It was right here. Chris, not a bear. Not a bear. I vaguely remember repeating those things over and over, and I must have seriously scared him. And I must say, at no time did he try to tell me to calm down, take a deep breath, or any of those other ridiculous things people say. As I was talking, I had backed further into the pole barn near him, but I kept my eyes facing outward. He came over and stood near my shoulders, and I chanced a sideways glance at him. He still hadn't said a word to me. He glanced down at the rifle and then outside again and then back up to me. Quietly, he said, "All right, all right. Listen, here's what we're going to do." He stopped and pulled the truck keys out of his pocket, and he showed them to me very close to my face. "We are going to go outside together, okay? I'm putting you in the truck. Then I'm getting in the truck, and we're driving back up to the carport and going in the house. Do you understand? Are we clear?" I nodded. I remember thinking how calm he seemed, but then I realized he hadn't seen what I had seen. For all he knew, what I saw was 100 yards away in the tree line. I also vaguely realized he was speaking to me as if I was a child, and I asked him about it sometime later on one of the 100 times we talked this over. And all he said was he wanted to make sure that I understood what the plan was, even though I was on the verge of hysteria. He did not want me running blindly once we left the barn. I do, as I said, remember nodding, and while I thought maybe he thought I was overreacting, I felt sure of it when he grabbed a hammer from his workbench and began to head towards the entrance of the pole barn. "What are you doing?" I said to him. "A hammer is useless against that thing." I held out the gun as if to show him we had something better. He shook his head and looked at me. "Jenna, I know, but that thing is not loaded." "What?" I yelled. He said, "Jen, I haven't had bullets for that thing in years." I looked at the gun in my hand stupidly, then I looked back up at him. "That's right. In my panic, I never once thought to see if it was loaded, to see if there were bullets. Bullets never entered my mind." My God, I thought. I don't know what would have happened if I had tried to fire on that beast or tried to confront it and only then found out I had no bullets. "It's okay. You can laugh at the dumb woman, but I say again, I was never trained with guns." So that was my folly for the day. But going on, we crept toward the open double-wide doors, and we both looked around as carefully as we could. Chris took a kneeling position and stayed back and tried to look around. When he felt a little more confident, he stood up, quickly stepped outside, and motioned for me at the same time as he opened the passenger door of the truck. I was getting in the truck when I felt Chris push me in, toss the keys in my lap, and slam the door shut. He sprinted around the truck and got into the driver's side. Then he took the keys out of my lap and started the truck up. You know, it hadn't even registered on me at that time that he threw the keys in my lap. I only became aware of it when he reached over to take them after he got in the truck. Many, many nights later, we brought this up, and Chris told me that as I was getting into the truck, he was pretty sure he had seen movement somewhere from behind and to the side of him along the pole barn. And his mind must have done a nanosecond thing, as I call it, and it told him that if that beast was coming up from behind him, no matter how fast he moved, he would never make it into the truck, even if he pushed me in and crawled over top of me. So his mind did a gymnastical leap, and it told him to throw the keys in, shut the door, so that if the worst happened to him before he could get to the other side of the truck, I could at least drive myself out of there. I have to tell you, I was pretty stunned when he told me that. But to say we threw gravel as Chris reversed the truck and almost did a donut burnout as we turned around to go back to the house is an understatement. And let me tell you, that beast was there. It might not have been directly behind Chris as I was getting in the truck, but it was there. And it really was some movement that he probably saw in his periphery, because while Chris had his arm over the back of the seat of the truck, looking backwards through the window to back up, I had a clear view of what was in the headlights. And there was something just to the side of the pole barn, the side that Chris had his back to as he got me in the truck. We sped up to the carport that was attached to the house and pulled in with the passenger side of the truck facing the house. We exited both of us from the passenger side and safely got in the house. By this time, we were shaking and trying desperately to get our breath. We did not sleep that night and instead sat in chairs we had pulled up next to the sliding glass doors that led out onto the deck. From there, we could clearly see the pole barn. The doors were still open, the lights were still on, and every now and then we could hear a few strains from the little radio that was still inside playing music. From time to time, the motion-activated lights around the sides of the back of the pole barn would be activated. But mostly, the most tense moments came for us when we would physically see one of the creatures walking around. And one of them actually did step into the open doorway of the pole barn. It just stood there for a moment, looking. We couldn't figure out what it was doing other than looking. Or maybe it was listening to the radio. We wouldn't get an answer until sometime later, but I'll tell you about that when the time comes. Eventually, it had seen or heard enough of whatever it wanted to see or hear and walked around the side of the pole barn and faded from sight. A moment later, the motion-activated light on the back side of the barn also kicked on, and a second later, we heard the sound of something like glass breaking. Throughout the night, a few more lights were heard to be broken. By around 2 a.m., all of the motion-activated lights were off for the rest of the night. When dawn came, we were both still awake. Later, we both wondered why we didn't call the police, and I can tell you I don't have an answer. I don't know. Maybe it was because deep down we knew how crazy it would sound, or maybe because when the worst of it was happening, there simply was no phone near. But no, we never called the police. We did go that day, that Sunday, to get bullets for the rifle, and we weren't sure about a lot of the local stores, so we went to Columbus, to a store we were certain was open and that sold bullets. Now, that is one drawback to rural life. Not everything is available all the time, and especially not almost 40 years ago. Then, and only then, after we returned home in the bright sunshine of a May afternoon, with a loaded rifle, did we both head out together to the pole barn and turned off everything in the building, closed, and locked the pole barn doors. We didn't know it that day, but we would not open those doors again until a moving company arrived in early August. Now, as I said, I was not very educated on guns, and while Chris was no hunter, he knew something that he hadn't told me at the time, and many of you probably have already realized it, and that is that a .22 rifle was really no defense against whatever that thing was. In Chris's word, it probably would have only pissed off whatever it was. He knew it wasn't much security or defense, but he didn't want to tell me at the time because he didn't want me to feel completely defenseless. He only told me this much later. Well, it's probably a good thing he hadn't told me, because I did feel a little more secure with that gun. Over the next 2 weeks, I stayed inside as much as possible, especially while Chris was traveling. I never went outside except in the full sun, and even then, I didn't feel safe. That little garden that I had spent all winter planning and through the spring tilled up, planted, and nurtured, I let it die. That's right, I let it die. That garden was right next to the pole barn. I wasn't going anywhere near it. The motion-activated lights by the pole barn, well, we decided we were never going to replace those. It seemed pointless. After the second week, I couldn't stand being there alone anymore, and I took to going along with Chris on his travels. I had gone from being a prisoner in my own home to being a prisoner in a hotel room. And let me tell you, I had nothing all day to do and every day to do it in. And daytime television in the 80s was not very exciting. We quickly came to the realization that we were soon going to have to make a decision. We neither one felt safe, and we dreaded going back home. Throughout the months of June and early July, when we were there for the weekends, we did see the creature several more times. Later, I came to find out that much of what we saw is typical behavior. We did have the stones being thrown at the house, although they mostly preferred to throw it at the pole barn. They liked, we thought at the time, the sound of the stones against the metal. We did see prints, but we never investigated any further. We didn't want to. We put the house up for sale around the 1st of August. We had had enough. And it was actually one of the last weekends that we spent at the house that we oddly received some of the answers to questions we didn't even know to ask. It was August, as I said, and the day was hot. We were out front loading Chris's truck with the last items from the house. You know, those small things you prefer to just transport yourself. We'd already gotten an apartment in the city and had the bulk of our things in storage. We didn't want to be there anymore. As we were loading, we saw a car come up near the mouth of our driveway on the road, and it paused, it stopped, and seemed a little uncertain before backing up and pulling into our driveway. We watched in amazement because for all the months we had lived there, no one had come up that driveway. We didn't know anyone in the area. We watched as the car parked and an elderly man got out and introduced himself as Kenneth. Now, Kenneth, it turned out, lived right up the road. He explained he had been sick over the winter and was real sorry that he hadn't been able to come over sooner to introduce himself after we moved in. And then he went on to explain that he had tried several times over the summer to stop by, but none of us had ever been home. And he was real sorry to see us leaving so soon. Chris mentioned something about traveling a lot and that I often tagged along with him. We chit-chatted a while, and Chris and I were a little put out and getting anxious as time was ticking by. What did this guy want? The whole thing was so awkward. We needed to get out of the property before sunset. That was our rule, and we still had a lot to do that day. It was only a few minutes into talking to him that the conversation turned from being pointless and small talk into pointed and Bigfoot talk. It started with a question from Kenneth. You didn't have any chickens here, did you? He asked. Chris and I looked at each other. No, Chris said. No chickens here. Huh. I figured they would have left you all alone since you didn't have any chickens. That's when the trouble started, you know, is when they got them chickens. Who would have left us alone, I had to ask. Them things. The people that was here before you, now, they had some chickens, and them things I kept a-coming every night, taking them, like it was their own personal food mart. And, oh boy, now the dam had broken, and Kenneth really started talking. It was like he had been waiting to spill everything all at once, but had been looking for an opening. You know, he said, One night, Bill and I, we sat right out there on that deck, a shooting at those devils every time they came near the hen house. It was like a game to them, like they was testing us, like it was a battle of wills. They wanted them chickens, and Bill wasn't letting them have them. He stopped for a second, and we waited. But, he said, we couldn't sit out there every night, no sir. And one night they just tore it all down. Bill got mad and started moving the chickens that were left into the pole barn every night. And then the dang fool went and bought more chickens. I told him he was a fool, but Bill was a stubborn old cuss and said he wasn't none scared of them things. I was scared of them things, let me tell you. Why, he even ran electrified fencing around the pole barn for a while. But in the end, those beasts won. Gave Bill a heart attack, one of them did. Yes, sir. The old man let that just hang in the air. Clearly, he wanted us to ask. So what happened? Well, Kenneth said. Apparently, Bill went out to feed them chickens one day, and them things must have been watching him, waiting. You see, Bill went out into the pole barn, and he didn't know it, but one of them things followed him right in. I felt my stomach drop as I remembered what I saw staring at my husband in the pole barn. Why, that thing just went right in, and I don't know what all happened. Bill never really would say. He wasn't beat up or nothing, but all I know is that when I went to see Bill in the hospital, he said he was a laying there on the ground in the pole barn, just a knowing he was a having a heart attack. When what that thing stepped right over him, scooped up two chickens, turned, looked at him, let out a roar. Then stepped back over him and walked right out. Yes, sir. Now, Paula said it was that roar that caused her to come out of the house with a shotgun and find Bill where he was a-laying. Well, I don't reckon old Bill won that battle of wills, no, sir. But it sure liked to kill him, I knowed that. Chris and I looked at each other. It dawned on me to ask, is that why he was cutting down the trees? Oh, yep, Bill said. Why, it was me and him. We were out there a couple of weeks with chainsaws and had Paula watching our backs with a shotgun. We didn't get to finish that. He trailed off. We ended up talking a little more. Mostly, the old man talked about how things used to be along that stretch of the road back in the old days, and every now and then it would come back around to the beast, but it seemed as if after the initial telling of what happened to Bill, well, it seemed like all the pressure inside Kenneth to talk about it had been released. And he seemed like a nice guy, but the entire 45-minute or so conversation seemed, well, just awkward. We said our goodbyes, and I was genuinely wishing I had gotten to know at least one neighbor out here, Kenneth. It might have saved us a lot of grief in the beginning, but who can say? After he left, we hurried with the loading and headed out well before sunset. On the way to the storage unit, Chris and I talked over a lot of the things Kenneth said, and we were stunned, but a lot of it made sense now. The cut tree stumps, the thing's fixation with the pole barn, and the weird obsession and aggression at the pole barn. Apparently, that thing remembered the test of wills between him and the previous owner. We finally left that house at the edge of the Blue Rock Forest for the last time, about 2 weeks later. The house itself didn't actually sell until the following spring, but we didn't care. We had already moved on and were trying to put this behind us. We didn't care that we now had the extreme financial burden of paying for a mortgage on a house we weren't living in, and paying rent for the apartment that we were currently living in. Financially, it was tough. As in, it was meatless spaghetti 6 nights a week kind of tough for months. But as I said, we didn't care. We went to sleep at night, hearing all the sounds of city life all around us. And we actually slept soundly, feeling safe, now that we were far away from the house at the edge of Blue Rock Forest. Well, that was Chris and Jenna's story. And that's all for this week's Buckeye Bigfoot. I hope you enjoyed it. Let us know if you did and hit that subscribe button or head on over to www.buckeyebigfoot.com, our website, which is currently in progress, but stop by and we'll keep updating it. Also, you can check us out on Facebook. Just look up Buckeye Bigfoot. Again, we'll be back next Sunday. We'll see you soon.